In the last example, we were given the stall current, that is, the current that a motor drew when it barely was not able to turn. In this example, we're also given the stall current, and we're told that the no-load speed of a DC motor is 3,600 RPMs. There's a linear relationship between speed and torque in a motor. Let's start off by drawing that relationship. In some textbooks, you might find the axes reversed, but I'm going to put the speed along the vertical axis and the torque along the horizontal axis. At a particular voltage, there will be a linear relationship as follows. As the speed gets slower and slower, the torque increases. And finally, at the stall torque, the motor is unable to spin. The speed goes to zero. As you decrease the mechanical load on the motor, it spins faster and faster until it reaches its no-load speed, or its maximum speed. We're given these two points on the graph here. We're told that the stall current is 1 ampere, and it's relatively easy to convert current into torque if we know the torque constant. We're given the no-load speed directly. When the mechanical load is attached and the motor is spinning at 2,500 RPMs, we're going to be operating at some point along this line. This entire line is valid for 12 volts. I could call this the 12-volt line. If we were to hypothetically operate the motor at some other voltage, then the entire line would shift. If we apply a lower voltage to the motor, then the maximum no-load speed would be reduced, and the maximum available torque would also be reduced. For example, this might be what the 10-volt line looks like for the motor. If I apply a higher voltage, then the line pushes out. Of course, it's not possible to just arbitrarily increase the voltage applied to a motor in order to achieve more torque or greater speeds. The wires used in motor construction have a finite diameter. If you push too much current through them, they'll get too hot and burn up. In this problem, we're operating at 12 volts only. So I'm going to remove the 10-volt line and the label on the 12-volt line. What we're essentially tasked with doing in this problem is to find the operating point. When the 2,500 RPM load is attached, we need to find the speed and the torque. If we know the torque, then we also know the current. If we know the output power, then we also know the efficiency. Let's take a look at the equivalent circuit for our motor. Let's first look at the situation when the motor is stalling. When the motor is stalling, the speed is zero, and consequently, the voltage drop across the mechanical portion of the circuit is 0 volts. Since the motor draws 1 ampere of current when it's stalling, I know that the entire 12 volt shows up across the coil resistance. The coil resistance is thus 12 ohms. Let's now look at the situation at 3,600 RPMs, the no-load condition. Since the rotor current is negligibly small at the no-load condition, I know that the entire 12 volts should show up across the mechanical portion of the motor. Basically, the motor spins faster and faster until the 12 volts shows up across the motor shaft. When you have 12 volts on either side of the coil, you end up with negligible current. This is the no-load condition. It's not too difficult now to find the back EMF constant because I know both the back EMF and the speed. After converting 3,600 RPMs into radians per second, we end up with a value for the back EMF constant. I'm going to put a box around it because this is a constant that applies to every point along that line in the graph. Let's now look at the situation at 2,500 RPM. We don't know either the back EMF or the current at this point. However, because I know the back EMF constant, I should be able to calculate the back EMF. Converting everything to SI units, I now have the back EMF at our load point. Since I know now the voltage on both sides of the resistor, and I know the resistance, I can find the current through the resistor using Ohm's law. The motor draws 0.31 amperes. I have a formula which relates torque to current, so I can find the output torque as well. The back EMF constant equals the torque constant. The output torque is just 9.86 millinewton meters. We're now left with only the efficiency. Since I know the torque, the speed, the current, and the voltage, I have enough information to find the efficiency. This motor is 69.4% efficient. In this example, we're not told the operating speed of the motor. In fact, we're going to find the operating speed where the torque developed is maximized. Let's take a look at the graph that describes the operation of a motor so you can see why it might have a particular point in the graph where the power delivered is maximized. We know that if you ask a motor to give you greater and greater amounts of torque, eventually it won't be able to spin anymore. You're asking too much of the motor. That point is called the stall point. The motor gets slower and slower the more you ask of it until the speed reaches zero. When the motor is not spinning, no power is delivered. In the case where the torque is zero, the motor is spinning just as fast as it possibly can, but there's no mechanical load attached to the shaft of the motor. This is the no load point, but again, if there's no load attached to the motor, there's no mechanical power actually delivered. For intermediate points on this line, of course, there will be mechanical power delivered. We're tasked with finding that special point at which the power is maximized. Let's start the problem by drawing the equivalent circuit diagram. In this example, we're considering a permanent magnet DC motor powered by a 10-volt source. That means that the line I just drew on the graph is completely accurate for this situation because that's the 10-volt line. We're not going to change the voltage on the source in this example. Before I label this graph with numbers, let's leave everything in variable form for just a moment. Consider a voltage V across a motor with coil resistance R, back EMF E, and current I. Using the Kirchhoff voltage rule, I know that the back EMF is V minus IR. Furthermore, I know that the torque is related to the current by the torque constant, and I know that the back EMF is related to the speed by the back EMF constant. Let's take these two equations and plug them into the first. I'm now going to divide both sides of this equation by the back EMF constant. This will give me an equation relating the speed and the torque. I'm going to write this equation one more time, keeping the constants in black and the variables in red. The resistance, the voltage, the back EMF constant, and the torque constant are all constants. The variables are just the speed and the torque. The power developed in the motor is just the torque times the speed. I can substitute in for the speed from the equation I just wrote. I now have the power written in terms of the torque only. Since I want to maximize power in terms of torque, I can take the derivative and set it equal to zero to find the extreme. The back EMF constant cancels from this equation, and I can now find the maximum torque developed by this motor. The constants were all given in SI units in the problem. The torque works out to be 0.025 Newton meters when the output power is maximized. We have an equation that relates speed and torque, so it's relatively straightforward now to find the speed which corresponds to that torque. It works out to be 100 radians per second. It's interesting that there's a point on the curve where the motor develops maximum power, but I should point out that this point doesn't necessarily correspond to the operating point where the motor is the most efficient. That usually corresponds to a different point on the graph.